Hi guys, welcome back to my channel. My name is Anna. I'm a clinical psychology doctorate student and I make videos about real life applications to psychology. In this video, I'm going to be introducing DBT by going into the first module, which is mindfulness. So first of all, if you don't know what DBT is, it's short for dialectical behavioral therapy. It's a subtype of CBT, which is cognitive behavioral therapy, created by Marsha Linehan. Marsha Linehan is a psychologist who was, when she was young, institutionalized for borderline personality disorder. And dialectical behavioral therapy is about balancing both acceptance and change. It's about these contrasts and integrating them. And it's used mostly for borderline personality disorder, but also other personality disorders, also depression, anxiety, relationship issues, and so on. So I will create a video for each of the four modules of DBT: mindfulness, interpersonal effectiveness, emotion regulation, and distress tolerance. So look out for those if you're interested in them. You know, I cannot possibly cover everything from the manual. It's very extensive, but I will go through the worksheets or exercises that most resonated with me, the ones that I think would be useful for myself, for my clients, and maybe for you. The reason I'm making this series is I understand therapy is expensive. It's not accessible to everyone. And while please do not think that this video can replace therapy, absolutely not. It is a completely different thing for you to be one-on-one with a therapist and to be going through this for yourself. I still think that for someone that doesn't have any resources, it's better to at least have a video explaining what they could do, how they could practice DBT. If you want to buy the DBT handbook that I used for these worksheets, I will link it in the description box below. And I will also tell you what page I got the information of each of these sections. So with that said, let's go into mindfulness. I'll be honest, I suck at mindfulness. After really going into this section, I feel like I can sort of practice it myself, but I am not someone who naturally is very good at this. The first component of mindfulness that I want to talk about is practicing non-judgmentalness. So this is when you leave out comparisons, judgments, and assumptions. This is on page 60 if you want to follow along. So you see, but you don't evaluate things as good or bad. You just state the facts. And you acknowledge the difference between the helpful and the harmful, the safe and the dangerous, but you don't judge them. You acknowledge your values, your wishes, your emotional reactions, but you don't judge them. For example, this comment angered me, but I do not judge myself for the anger, nor do I need to do more than simply acknowledge this anger. When you find yourself judging, don't judge, you're judging. So that's another thing. We cannot expect to practice non-judgmentalness all the time. So if you sometimes catch yourself practicing judgment, don't judge yourself for it. Just do better in the future. So here are some tips on how to practice non-judgmentalness. Practice observing your judgmental thoughts and statements. For example, a judgmental thought just arose in my head. You can also count judgmental thoughts and statements, like, oh, when I saw this person, I thought 1, 2, 3, 4 judgment thoughts. Describe the facts of a situation using only your 5 senses. Describe the consequences of the event and describe your own feelings in response to the facts. And remember, your emotions are not judgments. Your emotions are emotions. They're very valid. Observe your judgmental facial expressions, postures, and voice tones, including internally. So if you're someone that has a lot of negative self-talk that seems very judgmental towards yourself, observe those as well. And then the next step, of course, is change those judgmental expressions, postures, and voice tones. Another exercise is tell someone what you did today non-judgmentally and stay very concrete and very fact-based. So instead of saying, Katie pissed me off and she's such a blah, 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 and she's awful, state, Katie didn't text me back. Katie is busy at work, I know. I was angry because she didn't get to text me back. You can also write out a non-judgmental description of an event that prompted an emotion. So instead of telling someone about this event, you can write it out. But remember, leave out any analysis and just stick to the facts. And you might have to edit it because you'll see it's hard to just stick to the facts. And if you see any analysis in there, you can just cross it out, start over, rewrite it, only the facts. Another thing you can do is imagine a person you are angry with and try to imagine their point of view. Describe their feelings, thoughts, fears, hopes, and wishes, history. Imagine understanding that person. This is really a mentalization exercise. I've talked about this before. People with borderline personality disorder frequently struggle with mentalization, which is thinking about thinking, thinking about how other people might think differently from you. And lastly, when you are judgmental, practice half smiling. So that at least then you're kind of tricking yourself, you're kind of giving the other person the impression, I don't fully judge you. The next component I want to talk about is practicing one mindfulness and effectiveness. So one mindfulness means you're doing one thing at a time in your mind. When you're eating, you're focusing on the eating. When you're watching TV, you're focusing on the TV. When you're in school, you're focusing only on the class. This can also mean being very aware of what you're doing. If you're making tea or coffee, or while you're washing the dishes, or while you're cleaning the house, while you're taking a bath, while you're meditating, really living in the moment and not being thinking about something else, being very present in what you're doing in that second. And the effectiveness component is, you know, really asking yourself, is what you're doing the most effective way to approach whatever you're doing? You know, like if you get angry at someone at your school and you want to send an email that's angry, think about, okay, I want to do this, I feel like I have to do this, but is this the most effective way to approach the situation? The next thing I want to talk about is the dual mind. So like we talked about, dialectical behavioral therapy is all about the balancing of opposites. Balancing the reasonable versus the emotional mind, balancing the doing versus the nothing to do mind, balancing an intense desire for change of the moment versus radical acceptance of the moment as it is, balancing the self-denial versus self-indulgence. So first, let's talk about the reasonable versus the emotional mind. The wise mind is a mind that strikes a balance between the reasonable mind and the emotion-driven mind. So people always say, you know, to be the most objective, you have to completely let go of all emotion. And yeah, maybe that's the most objective, but it's not the most wise. A wise mind balances both reason and emotion. It takes into account both the facts and the effects that they have on people. So the reasonable mind is cool, rational, task-focused, values and feelings are not really important, very logic-driven. The emotion mind is hot, mood-dependent, emotion-focused, ruled by feelings or urges or moods or impulses. Why it's important to integrate these two is you have to see the value in both reason and emotion. And you have to acknowledge the wisdom within each person. For instance, you have to make a decision at work that will impact your coworkers. And you have to keep in mind the financial survival of the company, but you also have to consider the workers' feelings and values in order to make the most effective decision. Because let's be honest, if you completely go over your coworkers' head and they're not happy, then they might not be at the company anymore, and that will in turn negatively affect the company. Another example is, let's say your partner stood you up on a date because of a family emergency, and the emotion mind wants you to lash out, and the reasonable mind wants you to say, okay, I understand, and not express any of your feelings. The middle path, the wise mind, says, I understand, I'm disappointed that I can't see you, but I hope the emergency is safely resolved soon. So do you see how the wise mind strikes a balance of the two rather than being all emotion or all reason? So like I said, the second type of dual mind is the doing versus the nothing to do mind. So the doing mind is a discriminating mind, it's an ambitious mind, goal-oriented mind, it's focused on problem solving and achieving goals. I definitely am more of a doing mind. I am constantly wondering, what could I be doing right now? How could I be achieving my goals? How could I be getting things out of the way that I might have to do later? And I noticed that when I first started out in therapy, I was a little bit too much in the doing mind when I was in the room with people. I was too focused on, how do I solve this right now? What is the goal? How do I make the most of this time that we have together? But the being mind, on the other hand, is curious, with nothing to do, present-oriented, focused on the uniqueness of the moment, devoid of focusing on any goals. So for example, if you're in a conversation with someone really fascinating and you're just living in the moment, there's no real point to the discussion except that you want to learn more about their perspective, that could be when you're in the being mind rather than the doing mind. So again, a wise mind is a balance of the two. You're using skill, but you're also throwing yourself into the moment to work towards those skills. So for example, going back to me in therapy, I will help this person during therapy. Of course, I will try to use skill and try to get them to the solution that they want, but the most effective way to do that is if I fully listen to their narrative, if I'm fully present in the moment, instead of wondering, ooh, what do I have to do next to use up this time the most efficiently? So some ideas for practicing balancing the doing mind and the being mind. One exercise is find readings or quotes that you think will make you want to practice mindfulness in every day and put them somewhere where you'll see them regularly, like on the mirror in the bathroom or by the coffee machine. You can also put on wise mind reminders. So you can set reminders or alarms at random times throughout the day to remind you to be mindful of whatever you're doing in that moment. You can also choose one specific routine activity like brushing your hair, brushing your teeth, getting dressed, and select it to bring moment-to-moment awareness of this activity. So, you know, really select that moment to be thinking, how does it feel when I brush my teeth? How is the mint? How's the water? How do I feel about this moment? Instead of having your mind thinking about all the different things that you'll do later that day. Another exercise is when you start to feel overwhelmed, say, this is just one moment, just one task, to remind yourself to only do one thing at a time. Another exercise is notice both the pleasant and the unpleasant small events in everyday life. For example, warm water on your hands, the taste of a meal, the wind on your face, feeling tired. Really fully acknowledge these moments, whether they're good or bad. When you're relaxing after a hard day at work, stay aware of what needs to be done and focus on doing what is needed. So this is if you struggle with the doing mind, try to really do this. Try to really stay focused on what you need to get done so that you don't procrastinate. Also, practice willingness to do what is needed when you are asked or when you see something that needs to be done. So immerse yourself in that task when you know, okay, this needs to be done. And then there's this 3-minute wise mind exercise, which is when you ask yourself, what is my experience right now? What thoughts and images are going through my mind? What are my feelings and sensations in my body? And focus your entire attention on your breathing. I don't recommend this for myself because I'm a person that gets really anxious if I focus on my breathing, but maybe for you it works. And when you're ready, step back into your activities after 3 minutes of focusing on your breathing, or maybe if you're like me, focus on grounding your feet in the ground or other sensations. So the next component of the dual mind is the intense desire for change of the moment versus radical acceptance of the moment. So both allow yourself to have an intense desire to have something other than what is now, and also be willing to radically accept the current moment. For example, I hate that I'm so busy at work right now, but I accept this as a good experience and it will not last forever. And the last component of the dual mind is self-denial versus self-indulgence. So practice both moderation and satisfying the senses. For example, I really feel like having some wine tonight versus I've had wine the past 3 nights, so maybe this isn't really moderation. Maybe right now I need to rein myself in. And now let's go into the next component of the mindfulness module, which is observing, describing, participating. This is on page 53. So observing means noticing your bodily sensations, noticing all 5 senses. What sensory information are you getting through your eyes, through your ears, through your nose, through your skin, through your tongue? And pay attention to the current moment. Control your attention, but neither cling to anything nor push away anything. For instance, don't avoid noticing certain things, but also don't get really fixated on things. Have a very balanced attention. Like if you're just surveying the room, there's nowhere where you're just getting fixated on one object, and there's also nowhere that you're just trying to skip over. Also, practice wordless watching. So watch thoughts enter your mind and slip right out like clouds in the sky, and notice each feeling rising and falling like waves in the ocean. Observe both inside and outside of yourself. So I was recently kayaking, and the kayak instructor said something that really struck me, which was, I feel at peace when I'm focused on both my internal experience and my external experience. So it's about noticing both the surroundings of your thoughts and feelings, but also the surroundings of the outside world. It really has to be striking a balance of the two. This is very clearly a theme, at least within this module of DBT. So some mindfulness exercise ideas for observing could be observe with your eyes, observe sounds, observe smells, observe tastes, observe the act of eating, observe urges or impulses that you have, observe thoughts coming in and out of your mind, observe your breath, Observe sensations of the touch on your skin. Imagine that your mind is a conveyor belt and that thoughts and feelings are just coming in and they will soon come out. They're not here to stay. So the second component, first is observing, the second is describing. So put words on the experience. Acknowledge your thoughts or feelings. For example, my stomach muscles just tightened, a negative thought has just entered my mind, and label what you observe. Name your feelings. I feel sad. I'm disappointed by this microaggression. I'm mad right now. Another component of describing is ungluing your interpretations and opinions from the facts. So just observe the who, what, when, where. For example, instead of thinking, this person hates me because they talked over me today, think, they talked over me when I tried to speak up. There's less inferences about what their motivation might have been. It's easier to acknowledge that maybe they were stressed out, maybe there were extenuating circumstances, maybe they didn't hear you, instead of just going straight to the worst case scenario, the worst judgment, the worst interpretation. And remember, if you can't observe it through your senses, you can't describe it. So if it's not something that you can observe through your senses, like your heart racing or a car speeding by, you can't really describe it, so there's no point in trying to describe things that we cannot really sense. So some mindfulness exercise ideas for describing are practice describing what you see outside of yourself, practice describing what's inside of yourself, like thoughts and feelings, and practice describing your breathing. And finally, the third component, so it's observing, describing, the third is participating. Throw yourself completely into activities of the current moment. For instance, dancing, cleaning, talking to a friend, feeling happy or sad. Become one with whatever you are doing, completely forgetting yourself. So for example, instead of being self-conscious during a board game or wondering what people are thinking about you, completely immerse yourself into the activity and act intuitively along with the wise mind. So do just what is needed in each situation. For example, when you're dancing, be at one with the music. Have a good mix of reason and emotion. When you're playing a board game, be at one with playing a board game. When you're studying, be at one with studying. So some mindfulness exercise ideas for the participating portion is dance to music, sing along with music, sing in the shower, sing and dance while watching TV, a lot of singing ideas. Throw yourself into what another person is saying, go running and focus only on the sensation of running, don't be listening to music or thinking about other things. Play a sport and focus only on the sport, take an improv class and so on. And, you know, regarding all three of these, observing, describing, and participating, make a schedule and plan out several instances of each of these every single day. So on Monday, I will observe what I can see. On Tuesday, I will describe what I can hear. On Wednesday, I will participate in X, Y, and Z. And of course, it would be good to have a mix of all of these within the same day. So I recommend doing one instance of observing, one instance of describing, and one of participating every single day, if you can, more than that. And finally, the last component of the mindfulness module of DBT that I'm going to talk about is loving kindness. So loving kindness means being loving and kind to yourself, to a friend, to someone you are angry with, to someone who's difficult, to someone who's an enemy, to all beings. So list all the warm wishes that you would send different people. Like I said, it could be yourself, could be someone else. For example, if a friend is going through a difficult time, you could write down all the loving kindness that you want to express, sending them strength, validating them, complimenting their strengths, encouraging them, and so on. And then once you've done this, once you get in the habit of practicing this, ask yourself, did practicing loving kindness increase any of the following? Did it increase my feelings of warmth or caring towards this person? Did it increase love? Did it increase compassion, feelings of connection, wisdom, happiness, validation, and so on? So, to kind of recap, the things that we talked about in the DBT mindfulness module, practice non-judgmentalness, practice one mindfulness, practice effectiveness, have a dual mind that strikes a wise balance between reason and emotion, between doing versus nothing to do, between an intense desire to change the moment versus radical acceptance of the moment, and between self-denial and self-indulgence. Also make a habit of observing, describing, and participating in order to be mindful in the moment. And finally, practice loving kindness. So I get that this was completely rushing through things. I mean, it's an entire module. It's I think about 100 pages of just the handouts of the DBT manual. So there is so much more that we could discuss, but I hope that if you were interested in DBT, this gave you a little bit of insight into what it's like. Please stay tuned for the other three modules. You may or may not notice, I do not like working with mindfulness all that much. So I'm very much looking forward to the other modules, which I think are very important, but of course mindfulness is also important. So if that's your type of thing, I hope that this enriched your understanding of mindfulness. Don't forget to hit like and subscribe, and I hope to see you soon.